radar electronic warfare system for Indian Army. He was project director for development of advanced communication ESM technologies, achieved some reduction gap in self-reliance. He was responsible for successful flight testing of communication support measure system on an aircraft. Dr. Lakshmi Narayana sir was program director for Naval Indigenous Electronic Warfare Program. With 34 years of R&D experience, Dr. Lakshmi Narayana sir superannuated from DRDO service in April 2015 as Scientist H, which is Outstanding Scientist, and Associate Director DLRL. After retirement from government service, Dr. Lakshmi Narayana sir worked as a professor in Department of ECE and as a principal of Kshetriya College of Engineering, Armur, from May 2015 to August 2017. Presently, he is the director of R&D with Unistring Technologies Solutions, Hyderabad, and adjunct professor at Bharat Institute of Engineering and Technology, BITE, Hyderabad. Dr. Lakshmi Narayana sir has more than 30 publications in various national and international conferences and journals. He guided a number of PG scholars for their projects, and two scholars got PhD under his supervision. Dr. Lakshmi Narayana sir is a fellow member of IETE, IE, and member of AOC, ACM, and a senior member of IEEE USA. During 1997 to 2006, he served IETE Hyderabad section as a honorable treasurer, honorable secretary, and vice chairman. During 2008 to 2019, he served as IEEE Hyderabad section as secretary, chairman of MTT-AP-EMC Joint Society Chapter, and as also as vice chairman, chairman, and chair nomination committee of IEEE Hyderabad section. It is indeed a great pleasure to have you here, sir. I cordially welcome you, sir.
Thank you, Priyanka.
Thank you, Priyanka, for a nice introduction. Good morning to everybody.
Good morning, sir.
It's a proud privilege for me to be part of this particular, you know, STTM. Shall I go for my, you know, screen share?
Yes, sir.
Where it is screen? Okay. Advanced.
Sir, sharing option is
it is Zoom. Yeah, I'm just some right now. It's is it visible? Sharing?
No, sir.
Okay, let me see once again. Okay.
Yes, sir. Now it is okay.
Okay, now I'll start. Just Okay, once again, good morning to you all. Principal Professor G. Srinivas Rao Garu, Dr. M. Pradeep, Professor Anumant Rao Garu, Dr. Sudhir, and participants. Good morning to everybody. It's my proud privilege to be among you all. Just 1 second. Okay, I think we had over the last 2 days, you had an excellent sessions by Dr. Pandey, Prakash Rao, and Dundi Kumar, and my friend Dr. Raghavan, whom I met in Raghavan from NIT Tiruchirappalli. It's a proud privilege to be one of the speakers among these speakers. My journey was almost 34 years in DRDO. Presently, I am working Unistring Tech Solutions Private Limited as Director R&D. This is a small company, small scale industry, but it works on defense research products, particularly on radar and electronic warfare products, simulators and other things. With this brief, the topic is electromagnetics, microwave, RF and antenna design. And it looks like, I will be speaking on advanced SIN array antenna technologies. I thought that there could be some, repetition repetition from the other speaker, particularly Dr. Pandey, but I will keep it very minimum because for the connectivity. But otherwise, I felt that, you see, just talking on one antenna alone may or may not be good. So if we get into array antenna, it covers most of this, big topic of electromagnetics, microwave, RF and antenna design. Right. One second. Where can I? Okay.
Yes, sir. It is moving. Slides are moving, sir.
Slides are okay?
Yes, sir. Moving also. Slides are moving, sir.
Not able to hear you.
Sir, slides are moving also.
Okay, right.
No problem.
Right, thank you. Now, just as a continuity and, definition of the antenna, everybody knows. Antenna is that part of transmitting or receiving system that is designed to radiate or receive the electromagnetic waves. And the parameters for that frequency, radiation pattern, gain, input impedance, bandwidth, and polarization. The two most important parameters of antenna are radiation pattern and gain. These two things, radiation, why are we specific about the radiation pattern? Means if anything is radiated, it has to be received at a particular location, spatial location. So suppose if you take a transmitter of completely, let me say, anywhere you sit, for instance, mobile communication, for instance, radio communication. These are the things that means the signal which is transmitted should cover the intended place. So that means the radiation pattern is a graphical representation of the radiation properties of an antenna. This can be shown in polar. This is the polar and this is a rectangular chart. A polar chart or rectangular chart, the radiation pattern can be plotted to as a field pattern or a power pattern. Electric field pattern and power pattern, mostly we go for the power pattern. Generally, we go for the power pattern. So, one main lobe and rest of these things are the side lobes. We will be interested most of the time only in main lobe, particularly for any radar and other things. And the level of side lobes depends upon the application. That is the main design parameter. Generally, the antenna radiation pattern is a three-dimensional pattern, but plotting three-dimensional pattern is difficult, so we draw in planes, E plane and H plane, right? Getting into these things, what are all the antennas which we have? Over whatever the antenna you say, they can be categorized into one of these nine categories. Actually, categories, I would say. Dipoles, monopole, loop antenna, slot or horn antennas, microstrip antennas, log periodic antennas, reflector antennas, dielectric lens antennas, helical antennas, and frequency independent antennas. These arrays of the, now the moment I say, see the topic is, I told that I will be talking on array technologies. Then where only I am talking about antenna? Means, whenever we use more than one antenna for a particular purpose, we call it as an array antenna. Requirement is, just we'll discuss about that very soon. Why do you need an array? Suppose if you see, okay, just let me see, these are the wire type of antennas. Normally wire dipole, of course, nowadays printed dipole is also there. This is the conventional wire dipole, conventional wire loop. These are called the wire antennas. Looking into another method of radiation is the aperture antennas. See, this is, suppose if I show the horn here, this is the horn aperture. This is the aperture for the reflector. Right? This is the front fed parabolic reflector. This is the Cassegrainian antenna. Like that, there are many antenna types are there. Generally, we call wire types or aperture types. Aperture types include horn antennas, reflectors, and lenses also, right? And just, to show you a practical view of these antennas, this is the, patch antenna fed by a microstrip line. This is a theoretical pattern normally we show about it. This is a practically realized antenna. These are the some of the reflector aperture antennas, right? Now, before going to the requirement of the antenna or array part of it, we need to say about the gain of the antenna. It is worth spending a couple of minutes on the gain. Why do we require these things, See, gain of the antenna is, suppose the other day when I was listening on and off when Dr. Pandey was presenting due to other works, there was one doubt. What is isotropic DBIC, DB, something like that. There is a DBI and DBD means decibel means gain with reference to the dipole antenna. DBI is a gain with reference to isotropic antenna. Suppose if I take 1 watt of power and radiate in all directions, it looks like this one, right? Looks like this one, right? Now what will happen when increase a little bit, right? Looks like this. This is a sphere. What is the area of the sphere? 4 pi r square. R is the radius. That means PT by 4 pi r square is the power density. Power density means power per unit, square unit. It can be square meter, square centimeter, square millimeter. The whole power, instead of putting into one sphere, I put in a different, just in this direction. And rest of this, whatever the white part is there, there is no power for understanding purposes. So the entire radiation intensity is in this direction. So this direction to, that is here, the main beam here it is showing S to SI, I for the isotropic, the dotted one. This ratio is called the gain. Gain in this direction. If I show the gain in the other direction, zero. There is no gain in these directions. So with this one, the how much gain I want. This depends upon the area of the antenna. That is 4 pi a by lambda square. 4 pi a by lambda square is the gain. Of course, efficiency parameter is there. A means area of the aperture area or area of the antenna. Now, you see, if we want to increase the gain for a given frequency, what we have to do? We have to increase the antenna size for a given frequency. Now, for a given size of the antenna, how the gain will increase by reducing the wavelength. That is 4 pi a by lambda square. So reducing the wavelength. Reducing the wavelength means increasing the frequency. If you increase the frequency, means if you double the frequency, the gain will be increased by 6 dB. That means it increased by 4 times, right? So with this thing, so the size depends upon, suppose if I want 30 dB gain, 40 dB gain, means I need to use a huge reflector antenna, right? Now, instead of reflector antenna, we can use number of smaller elements. And now, suppose in the area, other thing is a covering of the radiation. If I have to cover this area, what will I have to do? I have to shift the antenna. I have to rotate the antenna in a given direction. So that means I require a mechanical rotation, that even says a servo or other any other mechanism. Is there any way to avoid this? Yes, there is a way, by using array antenna with the appropriate mechanism of feeding mechanism. So the moment we say array antenna, there are number of types of array antennas. One is the linear array antenna, circular array antenna, planar array antenna, and suppose these are the general things, linear and planar are the general things. When suppose if it happened to be an aircraft, let me say, a satellite, let me say, sometimes the antenna has to conform to the body of the platform. So that is where we talk about the conformal antenna, right? Circular antenna, there is always sometimes people are having a planar antenna, means antenna elements along the circular contour, number of elements, whereas a circular array means antenna elements around a ring antenna. Antenna elements arranged around a circular ring. Planar antenna is, example, a rectangular array or, you know, square array. Conformal antenna, the antenna elements arranged to conform to some, you know, non-planar surface. Now, what are the design principles? What is where the technologies come? Antenna is antenna. Okay, most of the time we think about it is a metallic part of it, some dipole part of it, or some metallic part of it. So that's where we always think about it. So it is not that way. So in the design aspects, we have to choose once the array shape. Just now I already told linear, circular, planar, and conformal. When it comes to the spacing, when I say array, suppose I am using the number of elements. When I use the number of elements, suppose, just 1 second. When I use the number of elements, how many elements, what is the element spacing, right? So this is what is required, element spacing. What is the difference between this thing? So this is normally represented in wavelengths. Now, element spacing, and whenever you see an antenna has got two parts. One is the radiator, whenever you see in the Balanis or any book, you know, how the antenna radiates, we keep on writing some, you know, this thing. But where is the input to the antenna? That is the excitation. Whenever we say in the excitation of the antenna, excitation constitutes amplitude and phase. So we need to feed the array elements with some signal which has got some amplitude and phase. If it is a single antenna, we have to feed from the transmitter to the one antenna input. If it is a number of array elements, we can feed different amplitudes to different elements, different phases to different elements. By doing this particular degrees of freedom, makes the antenna arrays are more attractive, right? And when we choose in the array, normally we choose identical elements. In these identical elements, we need pattern of the element also is equally important, right? Now, if it is in one element isotropic, that means the response is constant. If it is written in the XY plot, if it is in a polar plot, it looks like a circle, right? More than one element, array combining, this is the one input. The moment we are increasing the number of elements, we are getting a directional pattern. Now, if we increase more number of elements, what happens? The beam width reduces. That means array size is increasing. Suppose if you take the linear aperture, this is equivalent to the, you know, discrete aperture, right? This aperture, the moment you are increasing, this means beam width is reducing, means you can get more number of, I mean, better gain, right? Now, this is what is, I am applying equal, you know, excitation to all the elements. Maybe it is called, you know, transmit or receive. Here the diagram shows the receive pattern, right? Now, if you see that, if I introduce some different phases into the element, a particular phases, then we will be able to scan or, you know, shift to the direction of the main beam. This is the greatest advantage without physically moving the antenna. Simple greatest advantage is there with this. So this, with this introduction, we'll go to this, you know, normal, this array factor is fine. This is a routine thing. I will not be concentrating more on the, you know, mathematics part of it. Most of you are, you know, teachers, and I think students are maybe less number of students may be there, right? Now, one part is array factor, right? This is AN stands for the, you know, excitation. Phi N stands for the, you know, phases. Now, with this particular thing, we can get into, see the way we define this array factor. When the radiation pattern of an array constitutes of the two parts, one is the array factor, another is the element factor. The array factor is the pattern of the array when all elements are assumed to be isotropic. If all elements are assumed to be isotropic, this becomes sine n psi by 2 by n sine psi by 2, psi is equal to kd cos theta plus beta. This is what it is normal. This is everybody knows about this. Now, this is the array pattern obtained with the isotropic elements. Then what is the real antenna, you know, the total radiation pattern of the antenna array is that far field of the, you know, far field, the product of the array factor as well as the element factor. Element factor is EF theta phi, array factor is AF theta phi. AF theta phi, just now I have shown this thing. This is the pattern, this is the expression. Now, suppose this part, if you see, psi is equal to, earlier I showed only, normally everybody says that KD cos theta B plus phi, because we will understand that this is valid only when the elements are placed along the z-axis. Means that is the vertical linear array. Vertical linear array, right? Suppose if I want the, you know, array along x-axis or along y-axis, this psi value will change. If it is x-axis, kd sine theta cos phi. Instead of cos theta, it becomes sine theta and cos phi. This, so that means there is going to be different. So that is the reason whenever we say linear array, we need to specify the coordinates properly, right? This is one example of the linear array, which is linear array of circular aperture. This aperture, it is not a dipole, it is a printed antenna. Printed antenna can be rectangular microstrip or a circular microstrip. So this type of antenna is kept, you know, getting measured in the anechoic chamber. Anechoic chamber means normally when we measure the antennas, there should not be any external, you know, reflections. These are the, you know, absorber cones. These are definitely, these are the generally pyramidal absorber cone. If any radiation is incident on a pyramidal part of it, what will happen? It will reflect again. It will be along the, you know, along this itself. Suppose if any ray is incident here, reflection ray will be, you know, there, which is away from the snob. Then that reflection ray will come and hit the other absorber. Then it comes into the other. So any ray, incident ray will be shuttling between the absorbers, and it will be, after some time, it will die, its amplitude goes down, right? Now, getting into the other types of arrays are, see, conformal array, that means cylindrical array. It is slots are made on a cylinder. Three slots are made on a cylinder. Even array can have it on a conical. So what is the purpose of a cylindrical array? Cylindrical array, we can totally cover the whole 360 degrees with a single antenna, right? A conical array advantage is there. We can look into different elevation angles without getting the beam defocused, right? However, most popularly used antennas are linear and planar arrays. These are very, very specific arrays, right? Now, coming into again back to linear arrays, what are the properties of linear array? That's, we have already, I think something must have been discussed in Dr. Pandey's lecture, but however, we are concerned with the major lobes and side lobe. That means main lobe narrows as n increases. I have already shown to you in the three slides back. Number of side lobes increases as the number of elements increases. The width of the main lobe is proportional to, actually not equal, not necessarily equal to, width of the main lobe is proportional to 2 pi by n. Means the main beam will decrease. Suppose if only one antenna is there, 2 pi means 360 degrees by 1. It is a omnidirectional, right? Two, if it is like width of the main lobe, if there are two elements are there, it depends upon the orientation. We can't say that 360 by 2, 180 degrees, no. It cannot be like that, right? The height of the side lobes decreases as n increases, right? So with this, and the condition of, we say that suppose another property is, suppose if we keep the antenna elements, right? Depending upon the spacing, if the spacing is more than lambda by 2, there will be another lobe called grating lobe, which is not desirable. We have to reduce that lobe. Suppose if I say, take it. Now, just now I told that by n increases means what will happen? Beam width, decreases. Let us take an array of, you know, some number of elements, n number of elements spaced along the z-axis, right? Element spacing, we are taking lambda by 2, and there is no phase shift. Right now, there will be, let us take it that all antennas are fed in phase. When n is equal to 10 elements, if it is a half wavelength apart, means the array size will become 5 wavelengths, 5 lambda. When array size is equal to 5 lambda, the gain is 10 dBi, dBi with reference to isotropic, right? Now, if I increase number of elements, 10 to 20 elements, if I increase, what will happen? Since the array spacing is, I am keeping constant lambda by 2, here I am showing. Then means, that means I am increasing the array size from 5 wavelengths to 10 wavelengths. Then I am increasing the array size double, the antenna gain has increased by 3 dB. Means whenever we say that 3 dB means we are doubling the gain, right? It is in the decibel level. Suppose if I increase to 40 elements, the array size becomes 20 wavelengths, the array gain becomes, this is ideal, theoretical one, 16 dBi. You can see this, you know, as we are increasing the size, if you see this 10, 13, 16, the gain is increasing and the beam width is reducing, the number of side lobes are increasing. Whatever I have shown here, properties are showing in a pictorial way. Now, if you see that the gain is, you know, 2n d by lambda for a long broadside array. Generally, every time we need not go with a small, that particular, you know, mathematical expression and go on writing the code for that. No, not required. For a systems engineer, a communication engineer or any other engineer, for a system specialist, these are the formulas we use. But for a designer, while designing a specific antenna, we have to use the rigorous mathematics. Suppose if you see 2n by d by lambda. D by lambda, suppose if you say this is equal to half. Half means this 2 will go. So gain is nearly proportional to number of elements, right? Suppose 10 means 10 log 10, see 10 dBi, 10 log 20, 13 dB, 10 log 40, 16 dB, like that, the understanding particularly useful for that. These are the tips which normally teachers are expected to tell the students. Normally we get into the, when the, you know, during the interviews, normally students will be asked like this, if I increase the RSI, if I say, I mean aperture, if I double, what will happen, like that, right? Now, suppose I don't increase the array size. Increasing the array size by increasing the element spacing. Okay, I have got a number of elements are same. Let me say only, with only 10 elements I have got, but I still want to increase the array size. Means what will I do? I have to increase the inter-element spacing. I don't keep the inter-element spacing lambda by 2. Sometimes more. Suppose if I use only 10 elements, in the three cases, I'm using only 10 elements. If I use quarter wave separation between the elements, the array size becomes 2.5 lambda. If I use the half wavelength, array size becomes the 5 lambda. And if I use lambda separation, array size becomes 10 lambda. But still the number of, you know, elements are same. Here, this array size does not guarantee the 3 dB increasing. Here, what will happen? The moment we are increasing beyond a limit, see, other lobes are coming into picture. Grating lobes. So, in order to prevent these grating lobes, what will happen? We need to keep array spacing less than one wavelength, right? Normally, we keep for a antenna without phase shifters. When we are not scanning, we can go up to 0.8 lambda. But if we are scanning, means we have to restrict it to half a wavelength, right? Now, in the beginning, I told that the advantage with the array elements is that we have, you know, each element can be fed with a different amplitude, different phases. Suppose if I have an array, I will feed the center element maximum. Let me say I have got 5-element array. Center element, I will keep one watt. Second and, you know, one left, one right, I will have 0.8 watts. Again, edge elements, I have got only 0.6 watts. That is called the array tapering. Means as the center element will have the maximum power, as the elements away from the center, we will feed with less power. That means we are applying a taper. With this, this is when if all elements are excited with equal phase and amplitude, the array pattern will be like this. The first side lobe will be at about 13 dB. This is what normally we learn from the books, right? Now, if we apply taper, means we don't excite all the elements either this thing, then what will happen? Number of the side lobes will go down and the beam width increases. You see, here the beam width is pretty small, less than about 10 degrees, but here it is beyond almost, you know, 14 degrees, something like that. The beam width increases. So there are number of ways of, you know, weightings are there, Taylor weighting, other things are there, Taylor and Chebyshev, Gaussian, number of things are there. The Taylor weighting is commonly used for illumination function for, you know, phased array radars and other radars. Many other illumination functions are used. Amplitude and phase errors limit the attainable. Okay, we say that something, but every time it may not come just like this. Sometimes there will be some sort of, you know, variation in the side lobes that may be because of the amplitude tapers. Now, coming back to our planar array is nothing but linear arrays separated by a distance. Linear array. See, if you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 linear array, again, this is another linear array, third linear array, right? Fourth, like that. There are m by n elements are there, right? So we can have a progressive phase Because you see, this is the array factor again. If you see that, if you have n elements, let me say this is the array factor of one linear array. This is m elements, array factor of another linear array. That means planar array is nothing but product of two array factors of linear arrays, right? So with this background, let us proceed further. Grating lobes, I think this is the, what will happen. When the array elements are more than half wavelength, what will happen is the main beam, it appears more than one main beam forms. That is another disadvantage. The energy will not be there in the desired direction. It will go into the undesirable one. So if you see this in the spherical coordinate system for studying grating lobes, if we go to the sine UV space, we call it U and V, and this is this circle, we call it the unit circle. We call it as a unit circle. In this unit circle, we have got direction cosines. U is the direction cosine, sine theta cos phi, and V is the sine theta sine phi, right? Now, another this thing is when we arrange the elements, number of elements, when we arrange, what will be the, mode of arrangement? This is a very simple arrangement. All elements are equal. This is called the rectangular grid arrangement. That means if any number of elements, if you take, you can see rectangle. But if you see here, any three elements, there will be a triangle. Any three elements. Suppose if you write this triangle, this is, but you can say, oh, this is also right angle triangle. This also right. No, it is not that. Not that, like that. See, triangular grid means it is a equilateral triangular grid, right? This triangular grid, if we follow, there is an advantage by using, antenna spacing half wavelength, there will be no visible grating lobes. It means the pattern will be within the UV unit circle, and there will be saving of number of elements here. 14% of the elements can be saved. The exact percentage of savings depends on the scan requirements of the array. Suppose, well, most of the times when we go get into linear array, except for a Yagi-Uda and, what is that called? Another is that log periodic rest, another arrays, normally arrays we will use for the scanning purposes, right? There are no grating lobes for scan angles less than normally 60 degrees. Right, means plus minus 60 is the maximum, but most of the time we use plus minus 45 degrees. Right, that means one quadrant, we can say 90 degrees we can cover with plus minus 45 degrees without moving the antenna. Right, for a rectangular grid, half wavelength spacing, no grating lobes are visible for all scan angles. Means scan angles provided if you have the this thing, right? Now, what will happen, suppose if you see this, the red dots are nowhere near to the this, blue unit circle, right? Suppose if you violate this, or if you use instead of lambda by 2, if you use wavelength, one wavelength in the inter-element spacing, see the red dots are appearing on the unit circle, right? That means you are having a number of main beams, main lobes, which are undesirable, right? This any communication engineers, those who use that, periodic, these things, we can all Fourier series terms, when we expand certain things, we get it, number of these things, which is similar to that, this in the space domain, that is in the frequency domain we use, right? Now, coming to after this one, now, briefly, I have covered the array theory. Now, the technology, where the technology comes into. The requirement, I told that, it is the, what is it called? How the technology depends and advances are in the technology. The first, let us start with some of the known old ones. Means an array is fed by a power divider. That means suppose if it is a 8-element antenna, we will have a power divider of 1:8 power divider, right? Like that we can have, but then another way of putting is a Butler matrix. I can, you know, excite an antenna. We're using a Butler matrix. Butler matrix is the most commonly used beam forming network, right? Means normally from the aperture, if we want more than one beam, we can use Butler matrix, right? So the Butler matrix is, in its conventional form, is capable of producing M beams, where M is an integral power. Just now I'll show that. See, this is the Butler. The Butler was invented. Butler has invented these things. We call it as the Butler matrix, but forget about this. Suppose I have got two elements, element one and element two, right? These two elements I have to feed. Means I have to feed by a 1:2 power divider, right? 1:2 power divider. The best known one is that all of us learn in the college also, hybrid junction, all of you know, right? Hybrid junction, suppose if I, what are the properties of an hybrid junction? Hybrid junction, we have 90 degrees hybrid as well as 180 degrees hybrid junctions. If I say suppose if I give the input at port 1, for convenience, I say port 1R means the beam forms to the right side of the normal, right? 1L, I say that beam will get into the left side. Suppose if I feed a power here, the amplitude will be equal. That means if I feed here 1 watt, here we will get half a watt, but the phase difference will be here 0 degrees and here it is 90 degrees. Normally we should say it is minus 90, it will be lagging because it has to travel a little bit more time. So the moment if you say this will be the wavefront, normally the pattern, the direction of radiation, direction of wave propagation will be perpendicular to the wavefront, right? If we feed a hybrid at 1 hour, we will get a beam here. And if I feed it here, what will happen? Here 1L means this will be zero phase, this will be 90 degrees phase, the phase front will become like this. Now this is the radiation pattern. That means by using a hybrid and two elements, I can have two beams from the reference to the, 30 degrees. If you see, this is the beam direction, theta is equal to sine inverse of lambda delta phi by 2 pi d. D is the distance between the antenna elements. This is always there, antenna elements. You may say that if a hybrid is bigger, no, we have to use some cables such that we have to use the lambda by 2. Now, what will happen? The beam is oriented from array normal. If you use this one 30 degrees, this side one beam, 30 degrees, other side one beam will be happening. Suppose if I go for 4 hybrids. Now, I have got a 4-element array. I have to have 4 hybrids, means here it will further with the array normal, 2 beams to the left side and 2 beams to the right side. We will have it like this. So normally this particular part is the feed network. Actually, I should have put a dotted line here. This is the feed network, Butler matrix, and these are the array elements. Now, if you see here, in between, when I am using more than one hybrid, we have to use some fixed phase shifters. Fixed phase shifters here. There is a particular logic for these things. Hybrid anyway, I have shown here earlier. Now, if I put 1 hour, input at 1 hour, I will get right side one beam. And if I put 2 hour, another beam, I get it. And that means I can get it 4 beams. Here, if you see here, one typical problem will be there. Antenna is, this is the element number 1, element number 2, element number 3, element number 4. From the hybrid 1, I have to connect to element number 1 and element number 3. From the hybrid 2, I have to connect to element number 2 and element number 4. Now, if I have coaxial cables, here is a connector, I can connect to this. here is a connector, I can connect to this. But if I implement this in a printed version, what will happen? This is the technology. Next one, technology. See, there are hybrids are there. General, normal hybrids are there. We can buy there each one and connect like this. One of my student has done for one of the MTech project like that. Then afterwards we felt, why not to do it in the, you know, okay. Now, if I take it like that, a symmetric beamformer, I need to have, you know, 90 degrees hybrids and fixed phase shifters, right? This produces M by 2 beams on each side of the array bore site, each side of these things. This is the formula, right? So in the asymmetric beamformer, asymmetric in the sense, if I use, instead of 90 degree hybrids, if I use 180 degrees hybrid, in the 180 degree hybrid means what? Suppose if I say here, in the 180 degrees hybrid, this will be in phase, this will be 180 degrees out of phase. That is 180 degrees hybrid. If I put 180 degrees hybrid, what will happen? Once equal phases are there, it will be, the beam will be formed on the, at the bore site, right? Just 1 second. Okay, bore site. So that is, this is symmetric beam formation we call. If we use 180 degrees hybrid, there will be asymmetric beams. Means one beam will be array normal and M by 2. Suppose first M by 2 one side, M by 2 minus 1 other side. Okay, this is not very specific. Now, if we construct, this is the, these are the types of, you know, see, 0, 45, 90, 135 means this is one phase front. If you take minus 90, 45, minus 180, 45, like this, the phase will come. If I use, just now I showed you, you see, 1R, 2R, 1L, 2L. So that means I can get beams 1R. I'll get the beam at 75.6 degrees. Another beam at 41.4 degrees, 1L 104.5 degrees and 138.5 degrees. This is easily calculated, can be calculated with this particular, you know, formula. It's not very big mathematics, right? Anybody can do this thing. Then the radiation patterns, these are all array factors. Array factors. Now array factor 1, 2, 3, 4 means we can use element, assuming that these are all, omnidirectional, I mean isotropic elements. If you use a different type of element, you have to multiply with the element factor. That's all. It is to that extent. See, this is the array patterns of 4x4 Butler matrix beam formation, right? Four beams are formed. 1, 2, 3, 4 beams, right? So this is one of the antenna. A GSM antenna can be used, you know, multi-beam array antenna for GSM. See, these are the, otherwise, if you use a vertical linear array, the pattern will be fully 180 degrees. It will cover omnidirectional. It will cover. Once you use the, you know, vertical linear array, the number of, elements, only the elevation beam width will reduce. Elevation beam width will reduce, not the azimuth beam width is going to be 360 degrees. When the elevation beam width reduces, then this gives, you know, number of beams, like, you know, beam 1, beam 2, beam 3, beam 4. Now, using this type of beams, you can have number of channels here, or at the most, you can reduce the interference among the other things, right? Suppose if you have, this is one of the antenna shown inside, you know, it is just, you know, I showed you which is in that box. It appears like, but this is the connectivity among the array antennas, right? Now, if I go on using, can I go the way I like it? See, it becomes more complex. If 8x8 becomes more complex, right? So means number of hybrids, 1, 2, 3 layers. Means this is 2^n. It is has got exactly a digital signal processing principle, that is the, you know, butterfly matrix, you know, whatever we use in the signal processing, this is similar here. For 2 elements, it was 1 layer of hybrids. For 4 elements, it was, you know, 2 layers of hybrids. For 8 elements, it is 3 layers of hybrids. 3 layers of hybrids, 2 layers of fixed phase shifters, like that we will have it. So then what is the way of doing like this? So these are the things. We can have number of beams. The number of beams formed is equal to the number of antenna elements, right? Just one second. Then how many hybrids do I need? I need n by 2 logarithm of n hybrids I need. Suppose if I use 2 Butler matrix, I need only one hybrid, no phase shifters are required. That's what I have shown you in the first one, right beam and left beam. Suppose if I have 4 order Butler matrix order 4, I need 4 hybrids and 2 phase shifters, right? See, this is what I have shown you. 2 hybrids, 4 hybrids and 2 phase shifters for 4 elements, right? Then it comes for the 8 element. You see, you can see that for 8 element, 12 hybrids means 3 layers and 8 phase shifters. See, 8 phase shifters are there and 12 hybrids, 4 into 3, 12 hybrids. Like this, it goes on like this, right? Now, number of hybrids we can calculate. Number of fixed phase shifters, just now I have shown to you. Now, the position of the main beam peaks. See, when it gives a number of beams, all the beams are orthogonal. Orthogonal means one beam peak falls into the null of the other beam, right? Position of the beam nulls, right? And sector coverage, beam crossover. See, this is called the beam crossover. This is very visible. This is beam number one and beam number two. This is the beam crossover. So this beam crossover will be normally 3.9 dB or nearly about 4 dB. So this is why, suppose if you do not use, suppose if the other time, this is the array factor, all beams are equal because we are using the isotropic elements for the computation. The moment you are using the real elements, see, slightly element factor, when multiplied with array factor, as it goes down, there will be less gain to the other beams, like this, right? Now, if you go like that, 8, 16, 32, 64, this is simply not possible. Means it is a huge structure. So most of the time, people have used up to 8, 16, or maximum 30 to 32. So this is where the limitation comes. Now, how to do this? Okay, you are going to anyway do with ANSOFT HFSS, but a small one which we have used, IE3D. IE3D is an integral equation method, moment method, with a full wave electromagnetic simulator, right? This has got a simple, easy to use editor, and circuit simulator, near field calculation program. It has got its own, I think this may be nowadays part of HFSS also, I don't know. Right, IE3D employs 3D uniform triangular and rectangular mixed mesh scheme, but this is integral equation method, pretty fast, right? Using this method, we have designed one, you know, Butler matrix. This Butler matrix, as I told, we have used Butler matrix 4x4, right? 4x4 Butler matrix requires what? 4 hybrids and 2 phase shifters, as I showed here. 4 hybrids and 2 45 degrees phase shifters, fixed phase shifters, right? In this one, this is one hybrid junction. What are the property of the hybrid junction? If I put power at port 1, equal amplitude and 90 degrees isolated port is port 4, right? Here, with this one, at 2 gigahertz, S11 means VSWR or return loss at port 1 is minus 14 dB, which is pretty good. We need, it is more than 2:1, right? S12, right? S12 is 3.25. S12, this is, means 3 dB actually we want 3.25, 3.29. 3.25 means it is supposed to be half, 3 dB, 3 dB. But while the signal passes through the transmission line, there will be a finite amount of loss. That loss is 0.25 dB. So, but it is distributing the signal equally, right? And S14 is again isolated. Right? Now, if you take this one, then where I have shown you the crossover point, element number 1 from the hybrid 1 to the element number 2. Output port of hybrid 2 should go to element number 3, and output port of hybrid 2 will go to element number 2. So there will be a crossover. That crossover cannot be in the printed implementation. We need, this is the crossover. We say in the planar array single layer configuration implementation of Butler matrix, crossover must assure the isolation, because one is to, if it is simply a PTH holes type of thing, that was different, but here it is, it cannot be implemented like that. The main role of the crossover is to assure the best isolation possible. See, this is where we did it. Now, suppose if you say that frequency to S11, 29 dB, fine, right? S12, 25 dB, S13, 0.14, S14, minus 45 dB. That means what? S13 alone is, I want power from 1 to 3 only it will go, right? Because the power should go, see, this is one port, this is the other port. From this port, it should go to there. So power will not be coupled to this, power will not be coupled to this. This is what it is shown here, you know. S11 is anyway VSWR, right? Right? And 1 to 4 is isolation, minus 45 dB. 1 to 2, 25 dB is down. Very good. 0.14, almost only transmission line loss, right? This is the way we implement this. Similarly, for the other port, we will have like this same thing. And this is where, see, your two crossovers. This is one four hybrids, 1, 2, 3, 4 hybrids. Between the hybrids, we have the phase shifter length 1 and phase shifter length 2. With this, we have, you know, this is the printed Butler matrix. This is done by one of my M.Tech scholar from Usmania University. A good job, right? This is the printed version, and we have connected 4 elements and took the beams. It was working very fine, right? Now, I showed it is a number of elements only like this. Now, what will happen? Suppose if I want more this thing, can I have it? Can I go for any other matrices? Yes, I can excite this. I think now it is 11:05. Okay, time is plenty of time is there, no problem. Hope things are all right. Things are going fine.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, I am proceeding, right? Now, if you take this one, this is a case where I myself have done it, a 32 element array. This is a 32 element array around a ring, you know, around a circle. Each array, Butler matrix is 32 by 32, Butler matrix. But we need not have 32 by 32. We have got a different mechanism of modes, right? This is called the mode theory of Butler matrix, Rao. Okay, the operation of the Butler matrix with circular array is called the multi-mode array. This appeared in 1968, proceedings IEEE, right? How to feed a, means generate one beam and feed and cover 360 degrees, right? It is possible to excite simultaneously and independently all the modes, both positive and negative, from 0 to n by 2 by connecting the single ring of n elements, right? And outputs of Butler mass. N elements we have used means 32 elements we have used, right? Here, the property of modes comes into when the phase difference around the circle, right, is 2 pi k, means if it is, if all elements or Butler matrix, if I feed all elements in phase, that means mode 0. Mode 0 forms a omnidirectional pattern. Mode 1, mode 2, mode 3 will become the directional patterns. There is a method, we can sum the modes to get about 7 or 8 modes if we can sum, or at least 3 to 4 modes if we sum, we will get a directional pattern. Right? Such a thing can be in, extended to circular array, interferometer, up to 2 to 6 gigahertz, 6 to 18 gigahertz. We can have, see, this is where mode 0, mode 2, mode minus 1, mode minus 2, like this with 4 modes, we can, developed the circular array interferometer. This is the one digital bearing discriminator, which is, I am part of this particular one for the design of this, generates, DVD based on the Butler matrix field, right? This one, which we, when we mount it on the, this is particular system we have used, it covers like here. See, another one is huge grid reflector antenna, single antenna. Here, this is an array antenna. This is a single antenna reflector antenna. That means when we use, where we can use for high power and other things, where it is easier for array antenna, we have to use array antenna. But here you see, in order to move this array antenna, we need to have a servo here. We'll be using, but whereas we can't have so many servos here, we have used an array antenna here, right? Like this. The another method is lens fed array, right? Lens fed array uses the time delay for the beam scanning. What will happen is, now suppose this is called, beam ports. This is the one lens, means lens, lens concentrates, like in our, convex lens, concave lens, the principles of the lenses are same, but we are working in the electromagnetic frequencies, like microwave frequencies. Suppose if I feed from port number one, the propagation takes place such that it will go through the beam ports of so many beam ports. Are there some 16 beam ports if you take? Now, with port one, what will happen? This is the beam number one. This is the, line is there, beam one. It will perpendicular to this, the beam one will come. If I illuminate like this, last one means this is the least one, and that this is the latest one. Means here, any energy coming will go forward. Here, it takes a longer time to travel here and lesser. So this is the wavefront. This wavefront, beam in this direction. Now, that means if we excite port 1, beam will be at this one, beam 1. Port 15, this is the beam 15. So in between, another 14 beams come in between, right? This is the principle of the Rotman lens. Now, here, you see, if I have to go for the Butler matrix, I have a huge number of hybrids and phase shifters. I don't need this. This is another better technology. And it goes there, that Butler matrix is the frequency dependent. Here it is the frequency. Here the beam overlaps, right? Or frequency independent here. This mathematics, I don't want to confuse you. This is available in the books and everywhere. Same principle. See, when it comes, from the arc, it's focal angle alpha and maximum scan angle is beta. Focal ratio is G by F, right? G by F, and off axis focal length, inter element spacing is D. Suppose if we take with all these things, again, we are taking the, this is the contour of the lens where, this particular lens contour, these two contours are to be decided by this type of mathematics, right? This is one which is realized. It is not just on the paper itself. This is done in DLRL, right? One of our teams. This is implemented in the, see, such a simple one, you see, no hybrids, no phase shifters. Okay, phase shifts come from the length of the line, you know, these things. These are the beam ports. Here it is assembled. This is a linear array because it has to, it has to transmit very high power, right? Now, if I put one beam, two beams like this, this will be connected. This is only for the purpose of a little bit only shown to you. It is a bigger system. So beam ports, array ports, this is the, see, it looks like, but see, in order to arrive this type of thing, you see, this is required. Mathematics is required. Everything cannot be just, please, let's see that we should not get into that. HFSS is going to give me something and IE3D is going to be giving me something. That is fine, but we have to use it the way it is intended to be used. That means we need to learn a little bit more. So what is the meshing methodology? How the adaptive meshing is there? So that means we have to understand how to use it properly, right? Now, these are the beams, right? As I told you, if it is all are the isotropic elements, right? This would have been all are equal, but this is not all are isotropic elements, but the real element, this is the gain curve of the single element. If I take the single element and plot, this is the element pattern will be like this. So these are the number of beams, 15 beams can be formed with this type of thing. Now, why, where do you need this? Suppose if a ship is there, right? If a ship is there in the middle of the sea, put one missile, big missile or whatever, this thing, ballistic missile, and hold, blast the ship. Is it possible? Everybody will think of, no, ship is not keeping silent. Ship will have such, number of beams I just showed you. These number of beams are there. Like this, it will put four of these systems and cover all 360 degrees simultaneously. You can excite so that everywhere it is a jamming, this thing is there. This will be very much useful for the saving of the ship. So application for the lens fed array system for a shipborne application, right? Now, another method is there. Okay, I want everywhere. I don't want to, one is the Butler matrix, generate multiple beams. Another is the lens fed. Again, I can generate multiple beams required. Another third method is called the switched beam method, right? A switched beam method is a fixed beam forming network is implemented with this one. See, these are the number of elements. This is the beam forming network. These are the users. Suppose, like this, number of beams can be utilized, right? This is one. As a young scientist, while I was a scientist, see, this is what we have designed. I have designed, right? Here, you see, this is a 16 element array. 16 elements means 16 by 4. This one is a vertical stack. In each vertical stack, there are four elements, right? Such four elements, one stack, we have got 16 stacks. So 360 by 16, how much it will come? 22 or 23 degrees beam width. This is what we got. Now, should we have all beams at a time? Not required. Suppose in a battlefield environment, you need to communicate with one side only, utilize one beam. Or if you want to communicate to the another side, you can communicate this side or this side. That means you have got the freedom to have, you can have 16 discrete beams, whichever you want, you can do that. That information there also. Now, here, how we are getting here? This is switched beams. Suppose if I switch element number one, SP40 port one, SP40, this is a switch one, switch two, switch three, switch four. Here, port one of switch one, port one of switch two, port one of switch three, port one of switch four, if I take. Suppose you see, port one of switch one is going to stack one, port two of switch one, port one of switch two going to element number two,
port 1 of switch 3 is going to element number 3, port 1 of switch 4 is going to element number 4. That means if I switch port 1 of each switch, I am exciting 4 vertical arrays at a time, and that forms one beam. Now, if I don't want that, if I want next one means I will switch port SP40 port 2. If I switch port 2 is going to beam number 5. Rest 3 I keep as it is. Then I am going to beam number 2. Like this, we have got a switching mechanism. If you can see inside, you see the switches and there is a digital card. That means antenna is not just a radiating structure alone. Slowly, see, I showed you a little bit of there in the Butler matrix, only hybrids, purely passive, only another this thing is purely, phase shifters are all purely passive, that's a line lens. When came to the lens part of it, again it is more or less same passive one. Slowly when we are coming to the active components, we are increasing. There we need to know the microwave part of the principles of this one. So an array is here SP40, then why do you need TS, transfer switches? Ultimately, I am putting a 1:4 power divider here. You see, you can see 1:4 power divider, which is here somewhere here inside, and 1:4 elevation power dividers are there. Such 16 are there. So two power dividers I have got. With these I have connected here. I am connecting with power dividers to the transfer switches. Transfer switches will, you know, that I told you that taper one, that means element number 1 to element number 4, when it have got, there is certain, you know, amplitude is distribution. This will ensure the proper amplitude distribution. So this all together, the dotted line which I am showing, I am using it as a switching network, right? This switching network is fed by beam switching unit. This is the beam switching unit which is there, you know, I am saying here in the array. So all these things can be enclosed into the, you know, array dome, right? This type of thing, see, can any beam can be, this we call as a beam switching cylindrical array. So this type of array, you can see, this is a 50 feet mast, self-supporting mast. Mechanical engineering is also important. Now, see, the cables are drawn. Sitting in the cabin, we can select the beam through the beam switching unit. In a particular direction only I can communicate. Otherwise, what will happen? If we communicate everywhere, means your identity will be revealed. Some people may intercept your communication. First of all, if you do not allow them to intercept itself, is another great advantage, right? So with this one, this is one beam switching. So we have covered so far the Butler matrix, lens fed, as well as the beam switching. Another this thing is phase shifter one we have to get into, right? Electronic beam steering. So far, I have been telling only discrete beams, right? 16 beams, 32 beams, 4 beams, 2 beams, whatever this thing is there, only the beam steer. Now we will get into the beam steering point of view, that is the electronic beam steering. We have to use either time delay elements or phase shifters. Time delay steering requires switched lines, and it is relatively lossy and a little bit high cost. But we have to pay the high cost for certain requirements, because this is pretty broad band. For electronic warfare applications, we go for mostly time delay steering. Whereas for the radar applications, see, if you see, this is the phase shift is D by C sine theta naught. So D is the inter-element spacing, C is the velocity of light, and this is a time shift. This is the time shift. So this time shift is normally independent of the frequency. Here, same 2 pi d by lambda. The moment lambda is there, it is the frequency dependent, right? The phase shifting, mainly this type of phase shifting is mainly used in the phased arrays for radar. This is phased arrays for electronic warfare, where broadband bandwidth is required. The time shifting is not frequency dependent, but phase shifting is frequency dependent, right? Now, how do you get a phase shifter? One method, see, this itself is another, again, a component group of microwave field. Somebody might be on MEMS and other things, you know, MEMS phase shifters, MEMS switches, or, you know, other diode phase shifters and diode switches, ferrite phase shifters, ferrite switches. These things are available. So if you see this here, lambda by 16, lambda by 8, lambda by 4, lambda by 2. So all these together will become 15 by 16. Sorry, there is a print mistake here. 15 by 16 is the total phase shift. Depending upon the requirement, if I just switch off, only switch it this on, I will get 22.5 degrees. If I take all of them, 337.5 degrees, something like that. Right? See, the diode phase shifters are very well suited for hybrid MICs and MMIC. Again, another thing I'm bringing into picture. MIC, microwave integrated circuits. Right? MMIC, monolithic microwave integrated circuits. That means we are getting into small technology part of it. One is only the array. I mean, radiating element is a passive one. When we are getting into slowly getting, means adding more technologies, things are getting better and better, right? Now, the ferrite phase shifter, you see, this implementation is again in a, see, some toroids, we will use it. This is again a 4-bit one. But this will act pretty, high power. This can handle very high power normally. So diode phase shifters can be used above S-band, and about S-band and C-band, normally we will use ferrite phase shifters. Whatever one, phased array, Rajendra radar, Dr. Pandey showed, uses ferrite phase shifters, and that uses a lens fed mechanism, right? Now, the grating lobes, I told you earlier, for the linear or planar arrays, when there is no scanning. When there is no scanning, it is fine. See, lambda by 2, spacing between the elements, and theta is equal to 0, no scanning. Suppose if I scan to theta is equal to 90 degrees, what will happen? See, the red dot is coming here. Red dot is coming. The red dot, here it is, entire unit circle is free. That means there are no grating lobes. The moment if I scan the beam, the grating lobes comes into picture. This decides the, means we normally keep the, inter-element spacing only lambda by 2 because of this, right? Now, coming to this one. Big arrays. One is a Cobra Dane array, another is the BMEWS radar, right? These type of radars, just this I am showing is only pictorially here. Suppose whether this radar or that radar, see, this radar is having, this is upper 1960s radar. Each element looks like this. Hope you are able to see this properly. Now, if I excite one element, the radiation is coupled to its nearby elements, right? It will not go just like that. Or any incident wave, incidence on one element and its internal reflection, next reflection, it may get into adjacent element. The same is true with this type of Cobra Dane array. That means there is going to be mutual coupling. For this particular purpose only I wanted to show you. Mutual coupling means any element, any radiation from one element will be coupled to the nearby elements. What will happen? This is a bigger requirement, right? There is a bigger requirement. So the analysis of phased arrays is based on the simple model. So far in the mathematics, if you see, no interaction between radiating elements, right? That means what? I'm expecting that there is no coupling, but mutual coupling is the effect of one antenna element to the other. For instance, see, current in one antenna element, when this current radiates, suppose we expect that it's only in this direction, that's okay. Whatever the direction is there, that is fine. And this is coupling to its nearby element. Current in one element depends on amplitude and phase current of the neighboring elements. The neighboring elements will definitely disturb its current element, right? When the antenna is scanned from broadside, the mutual coupling can cause a lot of changes, right? One is antenna gain change, right? Beam width, side lobe level, and radiation impedance. So that is the reason while studying tomorrow, when you do ANSOFT HS, if you happen to design an array, you also try to see that there is an element, array element pattern. If that element pattern, if you take it and measure, it will be different. But if you keep into the array, its pattern will be different. So that is the advantage of the things which we have, that simulation tools which we need to have. Just 1 second. Right. Okay, so this is very important, but this is a topic by itself, very, very, big one. Now, based on this, now let us say that technology in phased arrays, we'll talk about it, right? I think this may not be a repetition, right? One second, may not be a repetition. Okay, I will just get into this one, right? All right, okay. Now, we have, I think one slide is missed here. We have three types of phased arrays. One is that passive phased array, right? And active phased array, third one is the digital array, right? Passive phased arrays, most of these things Dr. Pandey has shown to you, but I will be discussing a little bit on the technology point of view, right? From the technology point of view, what will happen? Suppose if you see this, entire thing is passive array, right? This array is passive array. The, phase shifters are there each year. Here, a high power transmitter is used, right? High power transmitter means it is called an exciter, or here, this one is used to have in the transmit mode, transmit amplifier will be there. This is transmit amplifier. Here, this is called, whether you call it as a circulator or a duplexer, the role of this one is while transmitting, just 1 second, during the transmission, what happens? This will be, transmitter will be coupled to the array beam, right? So this is the role of the duplexer. During the transmission, it will connect to the array. During the reception, it will connect to the receiver. Fine. What is the issue here? From the issue here is that here what happens is if the power failure is there, what will happen, right? Power failure is there, what will happen? The entire array will become blind. This is the single point of failure. So in order to avoid this one, we will go to the other things. Now here, amplifiers, transmit amplifier and receive amplifier. Normally receive amplifier will be low noise amplifier. The technology point of view, we need to say this is the beam former. It can be a, like, subarray type of thing, or it can be a power divider type of network, or it can be Butler type of network, whatever it is, right? Now here, if you see that the passive array architectures are, you know, significant military radar systems are S-band array, phased array. This is S-band Aegis phased array radar. C-band Patriot, just now, I think I will show you, and X-band J-STARS. This is the one, you know, phased array radar, right? This is a passive phased array radar. Then if you see the entire ship, where is the phased array? Phased array is a small portion of this thing. Yeah, this is the phased array. 1, 2, 3, 4, other two are the other side. We are not able to see that. This particular phased array is called SPY-1 phased array shipborne radar, right? This was first installed in 1973 on the ship and entered into the active service in 1983. Okay, even 1983, even if you take now, how many years it is? 37 years? Still it is working, right? Now here, what happens is, this is a passive electronical array. Now this covers what? When the moment we look at it, it covers 360 degrees, each covered by four arrays, right? Now it has got 148 modules, and each module has got 32 radiating elements, right? That means what? Totally it has got some 6 megawatts of power it is radiating. Total is, you know, 4096 radiators for transmission and 4352 radiators for reception. So here the idea is what? Our idea is, we have to appreciate it. During the 73s, the technology was up to this only. It is a very, very good one, up that one, right? When it goes to the, you know, another one is a Patriot. Patriot radar is something like, it is a radar equivalent to the Rajendra radar, what our Dr. D.C. Pandey showed. This is an array radar which is having 5,161 radiating elements, right? Right. Here, in addition to this one, this has got 2.4 meters diameter, this particular array size. This is the array size. All that for the outsiders, for us only, this is the visible. Outside electronics and other things, not only this, there is a linear array. This is the linear phased array for IFF, identification of friend or foe. This particular one will look after the surveillance part, tracking part, guidance part. What guidance it does? It guides for the missile guidance. This particular phased array radar antenna looks for the missile guidance, right? Now, missile guidance and identification of friend or foe is done by this 16 element array. This one in the Rajendra radar, I was one of the design team members in Rajendra radar. I am not showing that because it is already shown to you by Dr. Pandey, right? And it also does the special functions are there. There are a couple of other arrays. This is one array. These are other arrays for other specific applications. 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is a very, very strong Patriot missile defense radar. And during the 1990s, that is a Gulf War, this particular one was, used very successfully used. This is called ANMPQ-53, right? Now, this is the G-band radar, right? When the both radars are good, you know, this is another is Cobra Dane radar. Fine, this has got some 15,000 elements or so. This particular one is, you know, situated at Shemya Island, Alaska, right? This is a huge radar, L-band radar. Anything of the cricket ball size in Moscow, it is hard, you know, this particular fellow will catch, right? This was fielded in 1976, right? This is in 76 fielded, that is in 83 around, that is also some, that means most of the technology, existing technology between 1960s technology has been used to the for successful requirement of the passive phased arrays. Now, what is the issue? They are already, even now they are, some of them are functional, but as the things goes on, we always use, you know, from ambassador car, we have got other car, now we have got, you know, driving. what is it called, you know, electronic driving and other things, you know, like that, people are after that. More comfort, that means we need more. The way we see that centralized power amplifier is the single point of failure, there was a
lot of downtime in the radars, cell radars, right? And here, in order to push some power, you have to put a lot of power here. Means the power loss in the transmission lines until it reaches, see, directivity and gain, we say that, you know, gain is directivity minus the losses. So we have to reduce the loss. You know, producing the power is not a small job. So that is where we need to see, that there is, this is what is the requirement. So RF losses incurred in the passive beam former network and the phase shifters losses. Normally some phase shifters have got almost 3 dB loss. 3 dB means half power. If I produce 100 watts, then it will deliver only 50 watts, right? So that much of things we have to reduce the power, these things. So that is the reason there is Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency called DARPA. They have taken up some number of, what is called, you know, number of projects they have taken, right? So these particular projects, what has happened? These projects are taken from DARPA. One is that MIMIC project. It started in 1988 and completed in 1995. Of course, some of these things are going on in a low-key microwave and millimeter wave monolithic integrated circuits. This is the one which is the program meant for the next, you know, for technology upgrade. This particular one has established what robust controllable manufacturing processes, right, for gallium arsenide, means high speed, right? Gallium arsenide and low noise circuit, integrated circuit chips, multi-chip ceramic packages, accurate computer-aided and circuit modeling tools, automated wafer testing techniques, and advanced fabrication methods. These are the things which are required for the next stage of phased arrays, for going to active phased arrays. How to use it? And another this thing is high-density microwave packaging, HDMP, 1993 to 96, and MAFET program, means microwave and analog front end technology. So this particular one is, you know, the goal is that was to replace the design build technology methodology on simulated method. See, what will happen is we need to, earlier what we used to do before that, before this, you know, HFSS or, you know, IE3D or what is this, microwave studios, all those things. Okay, you connect one model, measure it, tune that, again measure it, like that. So that means in order to avoid the cost, you know, we have got into the simulator packages. Now, active phased arrays. With these things, means whatever the DARPA project's outcome, we have gone to active phased arrays. What are all these doing active phased arrays? There is analog beamformer is still there, right? Digital receiver and exciter, right? Here, you know, I showed here high power and duplexer. This we have shifted to T by R, where the phase shifters were there, we shifted this particular high power to here. Only we keep low power itself. We don't reduce. See, if I generate 1 kilowatt and lose it here, but I generate only 1 watt here, get it here, half watt here, I will amplify here. Here, TR modules will generate, this is the one where the single point failure is avoided. Even this, normally the failure in the low power is very, very less compared to the failure at high power. High power requires a lot of thermal issues also, right? Here, what will happen? The RF losses, again, see, if you see this, this is the transmitter, transmit amplifier. This is the TR module type of thing. Each one represents the transmit receive module. This is whatever I am showing here, TR modules. Each TR modules get
after the phase shifter, we are using an amplifier. You see, earlier, what we have done earlier? Earlier, here we have generated power, lost some power in the duplexer, lost some power in the subarray feeding network, lost some power in the phase shifter, then we have radiated. Now, instead of that, what we are doing here is very this small exciter power, small power here, right? Here, this is the phase shifter we have used, connected to a switch, you use it, connected to transmitter amplifier. For transmitter, you have to use it, circulator, transmit it, received one, again, switch back to this one, get into analog beamformer, getting into digital signal processor. So that means the technology has gone to the TR module based technology. Trans receive, TR means transmit receive modules. Each one, each element is having a transmit receive module. Suppose then if you have maybe for four elements, if you have one TR module, that is subarray method, we can use it, or each element we can have it. So the RF losses between the transmit amplifiers and free space are reduced. And suppose once you have the RF here itself, the next succeeding one, you know, noise figure will be high. So this reduces the noise figure because you are using lesser components here, active components you are using here. So noise figure reduces. And suppose if one or two elements are failed here, still does not matter. Still you will get the good, you get the good enough. Pattern, even 5 to 10% elements fail. Element fail means what? Amplifier fails here, does not matter. It will still, acceptable performance will be there, right? Just I will show you a little bit of more detail of the, you know, TR module. How much time we have? Another 15, 20 minutes, okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now here, MMIC, this thing is there. Gallium arsenide MMIC program, I just mentioned, you know, that outcome is implemented here. Suppose if you have your common leg amplifier, because it is a low power mode. In the transmit mode, I'll just connect it here. Transmit mode, it goes here. I will use the common leg amplifier, right? Common leg amplifier connects to the amplifier phase shifter and connects to this path, driver amplifier and transmit amplifier, transmit and it transmits. In the receive mode, from the circulator to, it will get limiter, filter and receive, this is a low noise amplifier. Then this comes to the common leg amplifier again, gets into, that means this particular two components, phase shifter, it is being used as the, during the transmit as well as the receive. The technology used in the TR modules was enabled by the ARPA MIMIC program, high density, microwave packaging and MAFET, microwave analog front end technology. These three programs as a result of this one. Now, with active electronically scanned arrays are now used in a number of military and commercial systems. The THAAD ground based radar, SPY-3 ship based radar, military aircrafts. Now, I showed you SP-1Y. This one, if you see, very surprisingly, SP3 also shows only this one to me for outside. Whatever the inside things, these are radiators are left it here. The inside things are upgraded with this technology, right? SP3Y, that is the reason they do it. Here, we need to understand one thing. We should not just run after the technology and forget the earlier development. The earlier development, we have to make use of it. We must use as much as possible and introduce, upgrade the existing one. Most of the passive electronically phased arrays, which were totally down by, see, 30, 40 years ago when they have been upgraded to active electronically scanned arrays, right? This particular THAAD ground-based radar is, you see, very huge radar. It's a ground-based radar, right? About 21,000 elements or so. Now, you see this here, because for the airborne applications, so far, whatever I showed to you could not be used in the airborne. This is a huge one, huge one. The airborne means we have to use in the aircraft. For those things were not useful. That is the reason DARPA has done these three programs, which we have gone to military fighter aircraft, F-15, F-16, F-22, F-35. This is there in the first F-22. ANFPG-77, this is a multifunction probability of intercept, low probability of intercept array. F-22 is a Raptor fighter. This is a fighter. This is a solid state active electronically scanned array. This has got 1956 TR modules. You see, so small it looks, right? It can perform beam steering of the order of tens of nanoseconds only. See, time is very important, very, very fast targets these are. It provides 120 degrees field of view and operates about 200 to 400, 240 kilometers with 1 meter square, this thing. And this also, well, little bit older technology only, 1980s, 19 technology. This is getting again upgraded by gallium arsenide modules. And with this, using gallium arsenide modules, the 240 kilometers range can be extended to 400 kilometers range. That means what? We are increasing the sensitivity, right? Right? Right. Now, the most modern aircraft is F-35. It is yet to be, you know, entered into the service. It is under trials, and Japan recently wanted to buy 106 or 126, I don't remember. But this is the one. This particular aircraft will be under production until 2070, another 40 years, 2040 itself, if the orders are already booked. So for this is the phased array required. This is called ANAPG. This is the upgrade of, again, this is the upgrade of this APG-77. This is upgrade of APG-77, right? It has got, you know, good electronically scanned features and more advanced technology. This is being done by, this is the same thing used for F-22. Now we can back and F-35 aircraft, right? Now, what happens? Okay, happy up to this. Most of the things I think I feel I have supplemented whatever Dr. Pandey is, this thing. Then what is the latest? That is a digital arrays, digital phased arrays. Now, the DARPA has introduced another program called WBGS-RF, means wide band gap semiconductor for RF applications. And another is the nitride electronic next generation technology. This goes up to using gallium nitride technology, which goes up to 500 gigahertz. And these two programs together, we are also trying to develop this compound semiconductor technology, right? Compound semiconductor technology with higher output powers, high efficiency, and higher frequency operations. That means we are trying to put the digital and analog circuits together, right? After that time, again, one more this thing is there, RF also. That is where we are entering into RF SOCs, RF system on chip. The DARPA technology for efficient, this is a mixed signal microsystems program that is called TEAM, and the scalable millimeter wave architectures for reconfigurable, transceivers. This is called a SMART program. So this critical technology is developed for highly integrated conformal arrays, right? The compound semiconductor materials on silicon. See, we are no conventional antenna technology is one part of it. Unless the antenna designers understand, we need not design everything. Semiconductor people need not design antennas. Antenna people need not design the semiconductors, but both should understand each other what other fellows are doing, what is available in the market. For buying a car, you don't have to become the car designer. You need to know its capabilities. Based on the capabilities, we buy a car. So that way, DARPA introduced compound semiconductor materials on silicon. And this particular program has been extended as the Diverse Accessible Heterogeneous Integration Program. That is called DAHI. These two things, they developed the transistor scale heterogeneous integration processes right? Integration processes to combine high power compound semiconductor devices. See, to define high power compound semiconductor devices with high density silicon CMOS. See, this is the where the mixed signal things come. And another thing is that arrays at commercial time scales. This is most important one. This is just a recent program. See, 4-6-5 years is nothing very great about it. You know, this particular one is, I'm going to explain this very briefly. Now, active array, where we have left it just now, we have to get it to digitized subarray and a digital array. Here, the difference is, here only analog beamformer is there. Here we have got analog beamformers as well as waveform generators. Here is a totally digital, right? The beam is produced upon signal summation at the receive level as well as exciter through the transmit level, right? Now, several digital, several element level digital arrays have been developed in the recent, but the huge bigger ones, just now I showed you, Cobra Dane, SP1 radar, that bigger ones scale is also under development, but normally not in the publications. Somehow they are not coming in the publications. This is for the information of the participants. Now, if you see this digital array radar is got, quadrant, this is only a small one, 16, 8x8 array, or, a 4x4 array. This is what 16 element array only. This is the one which is the, temporarily, sorry. Okay, this array is a experimental array. Here, Spartan FPGA with quadrant arrays, transceivers, and RF elements. This shows that digital beam forming at the individual panel level, it is going on, right? Getting on to this one, subarray level. Here, still we have architectures for analog and digital beam forming. You see, here it is the digital subarray beam former. It is analog subarray beam former. In the analog subarray beam former, see, these are the, sorry, transmit elements are there. This is the analog beam former. This is one big distinct one, right? And the digital beam form, this is will subarray. Within the subarray, we can have a digital beams, right? Where the subarray digital architecture incorporates a combination of analog and digital beam formers. In this approach, an analog overlapped subarray network produces flat topped. Analog array produces this flat topped beam, right? Now, sector beams with low side lobes. These low side lobes will inhibit any other grating lobes will come. See, these are suppressed by the analog beamformer. Even this will be suppressed like that. Now, where will we use this? These are the major consideration is multiple simultaneous beams are required where a limited angle sector is required for me. So the digital subarray, we will use it. Now, looking into the normal, this one, let us see that element level digital array, let us see. What will happen at element level digital array, again, the same architecture is there. Sorry, see, this part is same, TR modules. So from the active phased array radar to digital phased array radar, this part is common, active phased array radar. Whatever the down portion is there, this is undergoing a lot of change. There, each module will be having a digital receiver exciter. Receiver during the receive operation, exciter for transmitter. So, right? So at each element level, we can generate the signal and transmit it. We are not worried for the entire one bigger transmitter. At each element level, we will receive and push down to the central processor, right? So what are all the advantages of this one? Now, here, the key advantages are there. Suppose if I have here, four elements are there, right? In the earlier, analog beamformer or analog phased array, we used to have only one final signal here. Instead of that, we have here whatever the you know signal is intercepted by the element, its element information is available here. The total RF as well as the digital information is available here. The total information available at the aperture is represented by the n individual element signals, right? Whereas in the analog beamformer is only one is available. So the digitized element received signals can be manipulated indefinitely, and this can be number of beams can be formed, right? Now here the key advantages are that, you know, the main advantage here is operational advantages: improved adaptive pattern annealing, multiple simultaneous beams, antenna calibration, ultra low side lobes, right, and arrangement pattern correction. The key challenge in implementing there, it is not everything does not come just like that. In the digital beam forming, it is not just that, you know, keep something, remove it and keep in the digital. It doesn't work like that. The great challenge is that RF and digital have to work together. That means we need to look into the RF system on chip integration, system on chip concepts. Recent advances on silicon-based RF integrated circuit design fabrication are one of the, you know, greater achievements towards the low-cost element digital receivers. Now, highly reconfigurable digital receiver chips and embedded digital beamforming processing operated the over wide bandwidth is required. The mixed signal technologies, nowadays you will keep finding that mixed signal integrity, all those things you will be finding. Now, look, without going into, now RF part is anyway common, as we have discussed it up to active phased arrays. Now, where is the digital part? What are the effects of the technology? If you look at the technology, why you need to develop a new technology? It is not a passion to just like that go to the newer technologies. Here, if you take a phased array, here if you take a radar, 50% of the cost is for the phased array itself, right? Now, if you take this phased array cost itself, 45% is cost is going into TR modules, another 45% is going to RF boards and cabling. Now, where do you reduce the cost? We need to reduce the cost here in the TR modules as well as the RF boards. This is the hint here, right? Now, if you do it here, the implementation of the phased array requires a large number of electronic components, including MMICs, multi-layer RF printed boards, and RF cabling, right? The cost has to be reduced, right? See, there are two options for us. One is the slat configuration, another is a tile configuration. Now, suppose if I want to have 100 by 100 arrays, how will I go about it? I don't have to worry about it. Suppose I take just, you know, this is the 8 by 8. This is again 8 by 8. 3, 6, 8. 8 by 8, these are again 8 elements. So 8 by 8 arrays, I will just produce 8 by 8 arrays, number of them. I will suppose if I produce 4 of them, so I will get into 8, 16, 16 by 16, 64 by 64, 32 by 32, all can be done with one tile structure or one slat structure. Then which will I use it? The technology development, they both have got their own advantages and disadvantages. Slat approach has the advantage of providing a large surface area for attaching TR modules, right? Surface area is, you know, lot of, you know, places there. You know, if it requires huge place, right? And supporting electronic components. The disadvantage is it requires a large number of RF boards. I want 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 8 RF boards are required here, right? RF boards and cabling to the RF and control signals. Whereas the tile approach, you know, one board behind that all electronics can be hidden. This is the where the challenges are there. Now, but this is technologically superior. This is technological, this is superior in the other way around, in thermal problems. There are not many thermal problems here, but whereas here, there are a number of thermal problems here, right? Suppose if you see such a one is implemented this is multifunction phased array radar. This is a, you know, 64 element means 8 by 8 tile. This has been implemented at MIT Lincoln Laboratory. This is the one, which is the latest one, right? And if you look at it, you will be surprising, you know, what to do. Architectural building blocks, everywhere we say that mechanical and serviceability considerations lead to physical segregation of the number of elements. Suppose at element here, digital front end, we call it as digital front end. Each element will be having a digital front end. The moment it receives the RF signal, it will down convert, that RF portion will down convert to IF. Then IQ data will be generated, and the it's digital data, equivalent digital data is generated at the element itself. Then it is passed out onto the processor, intermediate processor like that. So the 64 by 64 element with 100 megahertz sampling bandwidth would have about 10 terabytes per second. Now you get into that. You see, it is no more antenna problem. Antenna problem is RF problem is getting transferred to digital people, right? The total ADC data process for a few beams is 20 megabytes per second waveform data is required. Virtually every digital array of moderate, large size, some form of hierarchical or systolic processing. This is either this is hierarchical processing or systolic processing. Hierarchical processing is each node data will be passed on to intermediate processor. Intermediate processor will be given to second intermediate processor. Like this, there is a processor architecture will be followed, right? Then what are we doing? If you ask final year students, everybody wants to do some project in FPGA. That is also not so simple nowadays. If you get into an FPGA for digital phased arrays, field programmable gate arrays are playing an increasing role in beamforming operations, lower power consumption, and faster data throughputs. This expands the potential applications of FPGAs in the phased arrays. See, this is from Mistral, this is from Alcatel, right? These are the black diagrams are shown as transmitter and receiver TR module. This is a TR module. And TR module configuration using the FPGAs, right? Alcatel FPGA, right? Now, I think I'm going to conclude with the last one, fruits of technology. All this, why are we doing? We want to reduce the cost. Everybody is interested in why are you spending a lot of money for technology improvement. See, multi-function phased array radar TR module. This is a TR module, trans-receive module. Here it is, antenna element will not be there because it is a TR module. If this TR module, if you say that, I have told you number of projects, you know, DARPA projects, for a 64 element tile, I am talking about for the tile configuration. Yeah, this is a tile configuration, right? This tile configuration. More clearly, this is a tile configuration. For this, but this is very expensive. I will show that also. For this tile configuration, in 2010 or 11, something like that, if it is $1, right? Or 1 lakh or $1, relative one, 1220, it come up to, you know, this is 0.2, 0.1, 0.01 or 0.2. That means almost 100 times, 50 to 100 times the cost is reduced for high volume. Relative cost of 64 element impact. Now, this is the TR module itself, right? Cost of. Now, this is the, of course, the total TR module, fully assembled MPAR tile itself. This is for the TR module. This is for the total tile. Total tile, which I have shown here, this is a total tile. This total tile, if I show it here, if you see, then which one shall I follow? Because I showed you both ones, slat as well as this tile, right? Both are 8x8 arrays, 64 element arrays. Then requirement is chosen, which one will you choose it? If you see this is the technology, you know, outcome. We have to see that when comparing, we should not compare apple to oranges. We should compare, air cooled to liquid cooled. If I take air cooled one, both are of not much. Even then it is about, you know, expensive. Even for air cooled, slat array cost is expensive here itself. But if I take it a liquid cooled, for, you know, liquid cooled may be required for larger volume size. Now it is, if it is $1 here, one here, this is 0.2, means five times lesser cost. That tiled array. So that means to sum up the microwave components, whether you call it semiconductor, pin diodes or MEMS diodes or any other things or FPGAs or all those things, things are becoming right from total passive arrays to active arrays, active arrays to digital arrays. This is the technology changes. And I think with this, I think I conclude. I think exactly 2 hours, 12:10, 8, I started. Thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. A wonderful session, actually. Any questions are there from the participants? Please ask individually. Participants?
If I see from the chat box, Raghavan Saab. Thank you, Raghavan Saab. Okay.
The question from the Niranjan is there, sir.
Yeah, Niranjan Kumar. Very important information, sir. Anyway, PPTs cannot be, whatever is recorded is recorded, right? Feedback link and Dr. Pradeep Kumar.
One question is from the Niranjan, sir. Happens when we mixed XL, XU bands frequencies to apply for the antenna arrays?
What happens when we mix XL, XU?